Call to order. Thurlow?
Here.
Brandt?
Here.
Geis, here. Hey, two things I'd like to, just to start with, to really accomplish. If on one and two, hopefully, we could formulate a staff report that by the end of the meeting, we could forward it easily to Spencer to get it on the full board agenda if we think that's an appropriate thing to do. So,
okay.
So the first one is any public comment? The first one is the district treasury and accounting procedures. So this is really a basic thing around the law, and the law provides a couple of options. One is, upon formation, the law says the treasurer of the county shall be the treasurer. However, there is an opportunity for the board during its life to select an alternative depository and be its own treasurer. That means it has to establish its own bank account, it has to establish its own investment accounts, it has to have a policy on investments, which is pretty detailed and pretty complicated. It has to have a treasury oversight committee. So there's a lot of stuff that goes along with being the treasurer. That I was once the assistant treasurer, and it took me a full quarter at City College to take a banking class to learn about banking. And then when Orange County went bankrupt, they made it exceedingly more difficult for the treasury and how it does its investments. And you got to think about this kind of long term of maybe someday we could be $1 million entity or a multi-million dollar entity. So you got to think of it in that perspective. At some point, like the cities, they act as their own treasury and they have their own finance department.
All the cities on the South Coast?
All the cities. Okay. All the cities do. Some of them are really poorly run, like Buellton and Guadalupe. How they're not bankrupt, who knows? But married to that is the accounting function. And so in Santa Barbara County, in the old days, used to have a treasury accounting system and used to have a financial accounting system, and we merged those together so that the treasury and the financial accounting system is the same. When you elect to join the treasurer, you get a set of banking accounts over in the FIN system. If that's all you do, that's all you get. You can also be a special district operating fund, and we probably have about 15 of those in the county, and therefore you get access to the general ledger account structure at the county. And that means you can have multiple funds. You can have, you know, it's pretty much aligned with generally accepted accounting principles in the state controller's manual.
And so, what's that called again?
What's that?
What did you say that was called?
It's called the general ledger accounting system.
Okay.
That's the first good question to explain to the board. So general ledger means it has asset accounts, has liability accounts, has all the balance sheet accounts. It has the revenue accounts, the expenditure accounts, the budgetary accounts. So it's a full governmental accounting system that's pretty difficult to, let's say you're our own small treasurer today, we could go get QuickBooks, but to duplicate a government accounting system in QuickBooks takes a lot of extra work to try and make that way. So,
So, you know, the bottom line question here, I guess, would be after reading all this is, what doesn't the county, I would be shocked if the county doesn't charge for
that was my question.
So for the treasury management services, I put this at the bottom. Okay. You're participating in a big treasury pool. It's $1 billion. And everybody pays their portion of treasury management services by the treasurer taking a fee off the investment earnings.
Okay.
So while the investments today might be making 1%, the district gets credit for 0.5%, and the treasurer's taking 0.5% for operations. If he's making 4% return on the investment, he's still taking 0.5%, and you're making 3.5%. So the district, going into this pool, having no money, it basically gets free services from the treasury.
Until it puts money in.
Well, now, it puts money in, but it still will earn its 0.5%. And because the system's so big, you pay very little for treasury management.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, is there something, I don't remember if this is on this or if this is that's something I'd read, but is it a charge per transaction?
Yeah, if you read at the bottom on the fiscal impact.
That's where it was that I read it.
Yeah.
And I don't have that in front of
me. Here.
Oh, thank you.
You have that, George?
I have. Is this it?
Yeah, on the second page.
I don't have a second page.
I'll give you one on the second page. So on the second page under fiscal impact. So the auditor in the old days, until budget cuts, used to provide charges to new districts only.
Mm-hmm.
And old districts were grandfathered in, but we changed that about 5 years ago, that now we charge, the auditor charges accounting transaction fees to the district. It's in a form of a fixed charge, but the way they formulate the fixed charge is by measuring your transactions that go in. So I would imagine, we have to talk to the auditor, that in the first year, you might not pay anything, because they don't have a record of how many transactions you're gonna, or they might give you a minimum fee and say, well, we'll enter an agreement and charge you a minimum fee or very little for the first year. And then it'll be based on your transactions. And our transactions are gonna be simply, in the beginning, deposits,
mm-hmm.
and then claims on the treasury.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a couple of things on the deposit side. I would say the deposit procedure is not as modern as modern banking, where you can take a picture of the check and get immediate deposit.
Yeah.
They don't have check 21. That's called check 21. On the auditor's side, it's pretty cool because online access, you now can scan and attach invoices to your claims documents. You can process those online, and you can set everything up to pay the vendor by ACH or direct deposit to the vendor. And I would say we should try and be a seamless non-check driving organization. And they also supply all the warrant stock and that kind of thing. A warrant's a little bit different than a check,
mm-hmm.
because a warrant, if you issue it, you have a 24-hour right of refusal if number one, there's not enough funds to pay that warrant, but usually the treasurer loans you the money anyways, they don't employ that. But if it was a fraudulent check or something, they have 24 hours to reject those checks. And if you say, well, what fraud's going to occur, I can give you 25 different instances of different frauds with checks over my career. So,
okay.
So anyways, I think for to start off, we'd be crazy. Now, the last alternative is if you name your own treasurer, the code does let you make the general manager and the treasurer the same. So if you had a really good general manager finance officer that knew how to keep a bank account and knew how to run a set of books, it's not impossible to be your own treasury.
Okay.
Now, I'll give you a good for instance. Goleta West Sanitary District had trouble with their accounting system. They switched to ours. Put their money in the treasury, $23 million bucks. What happened there is we couldn't do a very good job with we have a governmental accounting system, more for funds like ours,
mm-hmm.
and for an enterprise fund, we're not that good at it.
Yeah.
We only have a couple of enterprise funds. So eventually they found a better accounting system, mm-hmm. and they withdrew their money in the treasury because they forget that the county auditor and the county treasurer are elected, and they thought somehow we were going to get in cahoots and steal their money for the counties and the cities. And they said, we'd rather have it over here. And so,
of course you were. Of course you were.
And there were multiple attempts to go after their money by the city of Goleta. So they
and the county, and now the CSD.
Yeah.
So what are your recommendations? It looks like
So my recommendations are, number one, to just get the the board to understand the law, the 3 points of law, I think. Okay. And the first would be to affirm the county treasurer so they recognize they have a treasurer. I saw that little discussion in the, some minutes that that people don't get that part of the law. The second one is to affirm that the district not establish an alternative depository. Mm-hmm. And we can, you know, at this mm-hmm. time, I don't, I'm convinced it's not a good idea because I don't know who would do the work. Mm-hmm. And then request the county treasurer and the county auditor to establish a fund for the district. So even though the treasurer, it says the treasurer is the treasurer that shall be the treasurer of the district, if we took a check over there today, he'd have nowhere to deposit it because they haven't established a fund. And it's an effort of the auditor to establish the fund. They control the chart of accounts. And then request the county auditor to set the district up as a special district operating fund. That means you get access to the full general ledger system. And then direct the formation committee to establish an initial set of accounts to be used for accounting and budgeting. So that would be the next step after that's established. This isn't very hard. This is really starting to set up what a budget would look like.
Got it.
And you have to kind of select the accounting structure to do that. Once you're set up, it kind of just rolls over.
Right. And so that's simply to say, okay, account 101 payroll, account 102 general office, account 103, you know, professional services.
Right. Uh-huh.
And that would be something we would do at a subsequent meeting. We, this committee,
I think, would discuss what that accounting structure would look like in the initial year and what accounts we think should be set up.
And do you have any suggestions in terms of an easy template that we could easily look at and say, okay, now here's a startup district. And
right.
Here's what, because I think the last thing you want is to set up something with 42 different
right.
accounts.
So the code, there's a law, it says you can use these accounts. But they're all at the what we call the object level. So we can use that as a basis to
Got
start
it.
With.
Okay.
And then there's a special district accounting manual in the state controller's office for all special districts.
That's right.
It was last revised in 1979. And therefore, what they say now is, well, the special district should use the county's accounting manual.
Okay.
And so that has been updated more recently, but I'll show you something later in the agenda on insurance about even those, what you put in those accounts is a little bit old school. So we'll have an easy time to go through the state. I think we assisted on formation. We assisted Darcel with a preliminary set of accounts that they were using as a modeling.
That's right. I've talked to Jonathan about that.
Yeah.
And the sample budgets that are in the plan for service document.
Yeah.
I think that's where that stuff ended
yeah,
up.
Yeah, we could probably do that, and then we can refine that.
Mm-hmm.
You're right. You don't want to come up with a numerous sets of accounts, but we do want to comply with the state controller manual,
yeah.
and then that helps us comply with generally accepted accounting principles, which lets you put out a legal budget and lets you put out the financial statements.
Spencer, where did you say for the minutes, where did you say the sample budgets were set up in... Where were they set up?
It's in the IVCSD plan for service.
Okay.
Or plan of service.
Okay.
And then my last thing was, just to make the county accountable, maybe someday we request the treasurer and the auditor to come do a presentation to the district about the services that they offer.
Is that something we should do right now, or you think we should do that in a year?
That's a good question for you guys. Do you think it would help to have that presentation to make this decision, or do you think we can rely on the law? I can do the initial presentation of this issue and make the decision and then have the treasurer and the auditor show up and
right.
give us more of an education on what they can do in both near term and long term.
Well, I'm kind of thinking this is your total area of expertise. Mm-hmm. And if you were somebody else, if it was somebody else sitting there, I'd kind of say, well, maybe we should have them. But given the fact that you did this, and also that we don't have any money to put in here,
right?
It seems like this is something we could do in 6 months.
To set up the treasury? Oh, have them come. Yeah.
But otherwise, I think these are all great suggestions.
And then is my write-up of the executive summary, do you guys see anything that you would change in it? I tried to kind of follow the A, B, C, D, E,
mm-hmm.
and write it in a way that at least has something in writing. Mm-hmm. And then, you know.
And I appreciate that because it'll be easier for one of us to move it.
Right. And, you know, I saw some more discussion in the policy committee, you know, we long term. These are some of the things that I'm trying to do through this committee of saying, if you're going to do an agenda item that's eventually going to get to the board.
Yeah.
If we put some sections on it that are standard and get the members to write, that's how the county does it. They have a standard template and you mm-hmm. plug into that template
mm-hmm.
and you're always trying to get consistency to the board so they kind of know what they're looking for.
Mm-hmm. 100%. And right now, because the board hasn't taken any action, all the template is at my discretion as the secretary.
Right. And I'm just throwing some ideas out there for
template.
That's why I wrote it this way.
We should stick within the agenda item though.
Right. And then as the one attachment I put on here, it's the actual law. So if people want to see the law, I didn't put it on your copy probably.
That's okay. I looked at it because I remember printing it.
So we'll do these as two exhibits.
Uh-huh.
And then the one thing I was going to request from you, Spencer, if you send to me the letterhead, I could put this on letterhead and then send it back to you for an agenda item.
Letterhead for the agenda item?
Well, I'd say this is going to come from the formation committee, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so after we vote on this, if you send me the formation committee letterhead, I'll stick this agenda item on our letterhead.
Looks a little more official.
And then it'll look more official, and I'll make sure I live it. I might have to do it by hand.
Okay, so you're speaking about this thing here. Yeah, will do.
Yeah. And then when I do future agendas, I'll have that too.
Okay,
and I don't have to send you crap.
Good. I'll move approval of agenda item 1A through F. You didn't need any, there wasn't any additions to that.
Nope.
Okay. So I'll move approval for item A through F.
And I'll second. The one question that I did have is regarding, because the one concern that I have is I don't want to get in a situation where the auditor controller's office is saying, you know, you've racked up these charges for these things.
Right.
And we can't meet those obligations. So what sort of, I would want to have some sort of, I don't know, if, I don't want to say it's a policy because we're not making policy, but, and maybe that is something that's not within the jurisdiction of this committee, but there needs to be some sort of a safeguard in place to make sure that we don't end up in that situation.
Yeah.
Well, you only end up in that situation when you have money that you're spending.
Mm-hmm.
We're gonna have a chart of charges. So every time we spend money, mm-hmm. we have to know, and this comes back to whoever's on the board has to make sure they understand that you can't. We should never spend.
Can't just spend money whenever you want it because each transaction is gonna rack up a charge.
Yeah, and you should never spend to zero. Although that may not be, we may not be able to do that.
So you're not going to get charged by the auditor for making deposits.
Okay.
The only thing we're going to get charged for is if we process transactions.
Essentially writing checks.
And how much is that charge?
It's very. I can find that out.
Okay.
For the board meeting.
That would be good.
I'll find out. It's a little bit more complicated about how they charge. Now, if we became a real nuisance in there, using specialty accounting to do every transaction and had them preparing the transactions for us, it can get a little pricier. And so we, someone, probably one board member, needs to learn how to drive the system. And I don't know if it, I doubt if that should be me.
No, I think it should be the president of the board.
It should be the vice.
For now.
I was thinking maybe the vice president would drive the system, authorized by the president, meaning that maybe that in every transaction you do, it should be somebody preparing the transaction and somebody checking the transaction. And so if we had the vice president preparing the transactions and the president driving, authorizing the transactions, then I think that would be good internal control.
Okay.
The other thing that happens in districts is sometimes they take all the bills to the full board before they authorize people to pay. And I think that's a terrible practice because it just slows the system down. As long as you do the right purchasing procedure and you're asking the right question. Okay, Bob, what's the contract we're having with the auditor?
Yeah.
So let's do this. Let's
because that's the other thing. And sorry to interrupt.
I just want to do another agenda. I just want to add this as a second motion.
Okay. Or not a second motion, you're going to amend your motion.
No, I think we should keep it clean.
Yeah.
Okay.
I want to keep.
Well, then rescind your motion and make another one.
No. I want to keep this motion on the floor. I want us to vote on it, and then I want to take up your suggestion as a follow-up to agenda item one.
Okay. Yeah. That.
But it's different, and I don't want to make.
Yeah.
I want to keep.
I think that would work.
I want to keep these separate.
I understand what you mean.
And I'll try and get. I think they have an agreement with the. They put agreements out with the special districts, and I'll go.
Yeah.
Talk to the auditor's office, describe the situation, and see what kind of agreement they give us for the first 3 years.
So that's the other thing. In the recommendations, the action that we are recommending the board do is, or the main one is that is request the county treasurer and auditor controller to establish a fund for the district.
That doesn't cost you any money. That's setting up the bank.
It does. So there's a request, but is that entering a contract when you do that?
No, that would be, I would say you enter into the contract when you're, it'd be D. Request auditor controller set up a district fund as a special district operating fund. That would require a contract.
Okay, so what I'm thinking about it is we don't have general policies for how contracts are going to be entered into
right
at this time. That's something that we can certainly, maybe we should add that as a recommendation that the policy committee.
I think that's what George
that's
is.
That's where I'm going.
George is
okay.
going with his
so
second motion.
My second motion is to refer some items to the policy committee, but I don't want to add them into here because it'll complicate this motion.
I understand. Sounds good.
So here's what would happen. Let's say we set this.
Only the chair and the president can call for the question.
Yeah. Only the chair. What is it? Call for the question.
Only the chair and the president can call for
all
the question.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, unanimous. So let me do my second one, which is I think to answer your. So my second motion, and I'm going to have to write it as I say it, is to refer to policy committee, create policy for expenditures, or what do you want to call it, for
entering into contractual.
No, second. Agreement. The first part was we need a policy on who's gonna manage.
Oh,
our
a policy
set of
on who. Who conducts transactions?
Exactly.
Sets up accounts.
Right. Well, we're going to set up accounts.
Who enters into the agreements? Really, the board, right?
Right. But this is your suggestion of the vice president manage.
Oh yeah.
The accounts to make sure, and then with the approval. So that would be the first one. The first policy is a policy for the management
of
expenditures or. Accounts or management of accounts, management of financial
I guess in the absence of a general manager, should we appoint a member of the board to be the finance officer for the county?
Well, let's send it to policy committee and have them and have them.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah.
Okay, then the second piece would be to also send a policy committee to formulate policy on entering into contractual agreements.
That's right.
Which will take a little bit of work, probably, to look at the code sections related to purchasing. We're going to have the same issue later on in the agenda when we get to insurance services.
Yeah. Can I get a second to my motion?
I second.
Okay.
Call for the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
George is helping me run the meeting.
Okay, we're way over on that one. But okay. That's a really important thing, though, for the future of the district.
Agreed.
Okay, item number two is consider formation committee report on donations in order to forward recommendations to the board. So this is kind of lengthy, and I think we can shorten it. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
So I hijacked the county's policy on the first thing I noticed, it says acceptance of gifts by the district. I think we should edit that and say acceptance of donations by the district.
Well, up on the top.
Yeah. Even though...
Can I ask, does this cover grants? Should we also say donations / grants?
If you look at the bottom on policy exclusions, this particular policy does not cover operating or capital grants.
Where's policy exclusions? Is this
second page?
I see, second page.
So what's the history or background on that?
So here's what... And we're kind of getting into this situation with IBCDC. You know, I noticed at the first meeting there's a fundraising card out. The first thing I said is, oh, did they hijack our fundraising? And then the second thing I got back is a little pushback from somebody that says, well, you can't take donations directly. And I said, oh, same myth used to exist at the county. And what happened at the county is, you know, the sheriff formed the sheriff's benevolent council, the sheriff formed the helicopter council, the sheriff formed the, you
search
know,
and rescue.
The fire district had their benevolent policy. And what happens are, those are 501c3s, they can collect donations, but then they turn around and they're collecting donations on behalf of the county, and then they're controlling those donations before they get into the county's coffer, and they're like hidden funds. And what happens on those 501c3s, they really got to be arm's length, or they really are county funds. And in those instances, some of the employees were running those 501c3s on county time. Mm-hmm. And so the myth was, well, people don't want to give money to the county because we're the big bad county, but they'll give it to the 501c3 that can give it to the county. Of course, they got a sheriff's badge in return, you know. And so, you know, we had a lot of problems. They bought a hoist for the helicopter without going through county bid procedures, and then they donate the hoist to the county, and we're running a county helicopter with, you know, some hoist that didn't get vetted by county council and risk management. You're going, oh, that's public safety. And so after the blow up at the sheriff's council, that's when we put this policy into effect.
Okay.
And that you're going to notice in this policy, the way it's written, it's you know, it's got donor types in here that you can accept to get rid of that myth that, you know, we can, if you were, some people say, well, you can't take it directly into the county from taxpayers or individuals or partnerships. I go, well, if that's the case, then you can't take it from a 501c3. There's no difference. They said, well, it's tax deductible of 501c3, not to you.
But you know, it is tax deductible.
It's definitely tax deductible. Right. And, you know, that's the question. If you go on to the Internal Revenue Code, you call up IRS Code Section 170, it's like, I brought it with me. It's about that thick. This is the Internal Revenue Service Code. And the reason it's so thick is it's really from the perspective of that taxpayer. So it says the taxpayer can give money to the government under 501c1, which I put in the language that's in the code for 501c1. 501c1, a state, a possession of the United States, or any political subdivision of any of the following, or the United States, or the District of Columbia, but only if the contribution or gift is made for exclusively for public purposes. So we're a political subdivision of the state, and therefore you can take this, and it's tax deductible. Now, I looked at the little policy thing that they did for the CSDC website, and they put a little thing in there. Well, it's up to the taxpayers to determine if it's tax deductible. And we at the county said, no, we want to make it clear that these are tax deductible, and therefore we'll even give you a receipt. And that receipt doesn't say on it, oh, it's tax deductible. The receipt's designed, it's on the last page there, and I didn't construct it for the count all the way to the last page.
Yeah.
That accounting stuff I might want to eliminate for a while from the board letter, but that's the county's receipt. The receipt's constructed in such a way to make the county and the taxpayer comply with the code. I mean, if it's greater than $5,000, you got to get an appraisal. You know, so somebody donated to us one time an armored vehicle. It was a person in Montecito that had, you know, an armored truck. The sheriff just took it, didn't report it as a capital asset. Same with the federal government. We got a bear track.
Yeah.
$600,000+ donated to us. Board of Supervisors didn't know it, or the grenade launchers, which we launched tear gas from. They didn't know we got that donated to us. And so, you know, it's when you take a charitable contribution, it can be cash and it can be non-cash transactions. And that's why those two pages of the technical accounting part are so onerous, is because you can take cash and non-cash transactions, and there's a lot of failures on the part of government to not budget for and not record non-cash transactions. So this policy is pretty complicated. So It might not be something that, you know, something that the board probably wants to contemplate a little bit more, because, you know, and so the three things that I said is, discuss and review the issues in this staff report concerning solicitation, acceptance, and accounting for donations to IVCSD. That would be with the full board. And then provide direction to the policy committee to compile and recommend a district donation policy. And this is just a guideline, and I can give them the county's, you know, guidelines. The county's a little bit more complicated, so it's because it's so big. And we take donations for multiple things, whether it's for animal control or whether it's for probation or sheriff or fire or the health department. We actually get, you know, at the county, you get prescription medicine donated. And so theirs is a little bit broader on how do you, it's a little bit.
Prescription medicine for
Health patients.
For health patients?
Or mental health patients.
Mental health patients. So yeah. Behavioral wellness?
Yeah.
Okay.
takes
it's a great deal for the pharmaceuticals.
Yeah.
Because they donate at the cost, and their cost are pennies, but yeah. They donate it at the retail.
Right. So there's a lot of stuff in here that people should be concentrating on. It gets around to the ethics class too, you know, a little bit, you know.
Yeah.
Why are people giving you money? What do they expect in return?
Right.
You know, we're a government agency. When do you put that donation on the public agenda? And when can the, just like the general manager, when and if we ever had one, or the, and I substituted in here that the president and the vice president could accept the donation less than $10,000. We don't want to make it so it's so,
yeah.
You know, and there's a lot of people that want to give to 501c3s because they want to stay anonymous. So they give it to the 501c3, they stay anonymous to the bigger organization, but...
We can't accept, under the county policy, no anonymous donations. That's interesting.
I think on the lower level, not all donations less than 10,000 are, you know, they can be accepted by... the department heads, and so they sort of remain anonymous. But if somebody asked for them, they wouldn't be anonymous.
Okay.
You probably can't take an anonymous donation.
A government agency can. Well,
not in the real, when you really get down to Public Records Act. If somebody gives you a check, I would say if somebody came
it's
and
an gave, interesting. It's an interesting issue. It's been litigated at the university, and I think at the very, very end of the day, you can force it to be made public.
That's what I'd say.
Yeah, but here's a question I had in terms of making a motion on this. Do we want to recommend discussion of a strategic plan at the board level? Because having the 7-member board discuss a strategic plan for soliciting donations seems like that's
not
a good, from efficiency point of view, that when you want, if you want to discuss a strategic plan, you give it to a committee.
I think that in terms of how this, where this gets pushed, I think a strategic plan would be done at the formation level, in the formation committee, and maybe that's a future agenda item.
That's exactly what I want to do.
Okay,
is
so direct the
whatever
formation.
These three things are here, or whatever we want to forward to the board. If we want to say,
I would suggest we direct the board. That we recommend to the board to direct the formation committee to discuss a strategic plan, short term and long term.
Yeah, that would be good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And I would also say, for the second recommendation, we're not going to provide direction to the policy committee. We're going to recommend that the board provide.
Yeah.
Oh wait. Oh, never mind. I see that recommendations that the formation committee recommend that the IVC trustee board of directors :
Yeah, so the number three was the formation committee recommend that IVC board of directors on number three.
Mm-hmm.
What'd you say there, George? Refer to the
formation committee. Direct the formation committee to discuss a strategic plan, blah, 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 both short term and long term. Mm-hmm. But I'm thinking, now that you mentioned number two, do we want to have this particular item in two different committees? Doesn't it make sense to keep it in one committee? Create the policy and then the strategic plan, or does it matter?
No, because the policies are what's going to guide how a strategic plan would be done. I mean, from my perspective, one of them is more of an outreach thing.
Okay. Well, then how about Brian?
Because when I wrote this up, you know, I was doing it from, I was bastardizing the county's policy on gifts. So I said, well, it belongs in the, you know, I shouldn't be writing policy. That's the policy committee's objective. And so this was just a way I'm trying to just say, well, here's the county's, here's a bastardized version of the county's policy.
Okay.
And
yeah.
Right.
you know.
No, I agree.
Yeah, and I think that that's good, and I think that, I mean, because the board, so the recommendation is that the board discuss and review the staff report, not adopt this policy, like this exact policy.
Oh, yeah,
which
right.
Which is good, because we can't get into policy stuff on this committee. The other, but one of the things I wanted to get into was that regarding the IBCDC's fundraising efforts, I would just say that from my perspective, it seems like it would be a lot more efficient for the board and for the district if there was a fundraising effort going on that the board didn't, that the board didn't have to be like in the thick of. So I'm not entirely, I don't think there should be parallel fundraising efforts, but I think in the future I'll definitely reach out to folks who are involved in the CDC and are involved in that effort and try to figure out what exactly they're doing, and so that we can coordinate with them, because I think that there's a good partnership to be forged on that end.
Yeah, when I first saw that, I thought that if IBCDC is out there fundraising for us, that fundraising effort should be understood by the full board, and the board should either authorize that or at least understand how the money is going to flow back to us. Because, you know, people don't understand the difference between IBCDC and Isla Vista Community Service District. And, you know, I said, okay, God darn it, I know what the IBCDC is, but I don't really know what they are. So I went up, looked at their website, and their mission is to, you know, buy community buildings for public purposes. And so are they raising money to buy community buildings to be operated by us? What are they going to do with the $40,000? Are they fundraising to make a donation to us for administration? I don't know what they're fundraising for.
Wouldn't it make sense to invite one of their representatives to the next board meeting and just give us a report?
I think that would be great. I think that one of the things, and we can do that at the committee level, is we can. Well, it wouldn't be a recommendation.
Well, this would be one. Well, we're just recommending it to you to agendize. That's what I would say for the full board. And I really think this is one of those things that should come in front of the full board, so that everybody is on the same page about the, I mean, you know, what is our relationship with IVCDC and particularly with fundraising? Because it does open all kinds of.
Well, it opens up this door where we have the sheriff.
Do they get
helicopter
badges?
Program, yeah, exactly. Raising money for the sheriff and restricting it to helicopters. And then we got IBCDC. Are they raising money on our behalf and going to restrict it to only be spent on
buildings?
Yeah,
buying community buildings?
There definitely needs to be a representative who gives us some sort of a presentation.
Yeah.
Can we coordinate that?
Yeah, I can reach out to the president of IBCDC.
I think that'd be a good idea.
I mean, it really would be, you know, us getting on board. If they're raising money on our behalf and they're good at fundraising, then I don't care who raises money if they're going to help us in the near term to fund administration, which is like, the more I read that ethics thing, the more I'm going, damn, we need that building space over there, because who's our custodian of the records? Is everything being with Spencer?
I'm very concerned about custodian of the records.
Yeah.
I think that's that's probably our biggest downfall. But let me keep us on track here and make a motion. And my motion would be to accept the recommendations that you've made, with the exception of number three, which would be to direct the recommend to the board to direct the formation committee to discuss strategic plan, blah, blah, blah. So in other words, we would accept items 1, 2, and 3.
And yeah. Yeah, not get into the thing with the strategic plan, but I don't know, I'd like to get somebody, and this is where we could use a volunteer. You know, if we had a separate committee on soliciting donations, I'd want to have somebody that really knows how to do it. You probably do because you're in alumni affairs and do a lot
of
that.
We do it, but after taking the ethics course, I need to get an opinion from the Office of General Counsel at UC as to whether I'm allowed to solicit donations.
Right. That is a very interesting dilemma.
Did you see that little thing?
Well, I see on your part that, you know, do you solicit for them or do you solicit for them?
Well, that's a problem. Yeah. That's a problem.
Yeah. Because
but that's not the problem. The CSD shouldn't have any problem with that.
No.
I'll tell you who's going to have a problem with that.
The chancellor. We're their competition because the first thing I said is, what's the name of that committee you guys have that we could solicit donations from? Yeah. Who runs the alumni affairs? Yeah. I want some money from alumni affairs.
So, I'll second your motion. Okay. I would say that can we make it clear that the recommendation is that the board direct push the strategic plan back to the formation committee.
Exactly. Yeah.
Direct the formation committee to discuss a strategic plan. How's that?
Short term and long term.
Okay.
In the near term for administration activities of the district and a long term strategy to support district programs.
Okay.
And the second one is direct the policy committee to compile and recommend a district donation policy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We're not directing the policy committee, we're recommending.
So in terms of the content of the report that I send forward, should I take these procedures for cash donations and non-cash donations off?
I wouldn't.
Just leave them there?
I would.
Because I think
For the report?
Yeah.
No, I think those should be left in there.
Yeah, because I think this is important and the receipt's important. You know?
Agreed. Can I borrow another piece of paper?
Go ahead.
All right. Paper here.
You're killing me, George.
We're 20 minutes.
Are we done with this item? Did we?
Yeah.
We met, accept?
Yeah.
God, we're not.
You're looking nice. I ripped it a little nicer this time, too.
All right.
We're going to break the internship 40 minutes.
Here we go.
Right?
The next item is discussing insurance coverage for the board of directors.
Wait, do we need to vote on that?
We did. Did we? Call for the question?
Aye.
Okay.
This is the thorny one, right?
So
this is the one that's going to keep us up at night.
Yeah. Well, this is just the start. I don't have anything to take to the board of directors unless we concoct something. So here's a thing where I just took the insurance things out of the state controller's manual, and these are the kinds of insurances that they say. Oh, if you enter into an insurance contract for any of this stuff, then you know, this is where you would record it in this line item. But the only reason I attach this is because here's one thing of the various kinds of insurance coverage that you may want to have. But in terms of the formation of the district, I don't think we need fire, we don't need burglary, we don't need collision. What we do need is public liability, or in the more modern terms, they call it general liability insurance.
Uh-huh.
We don't have any property.
I think we should have false arrest.
False arrest, yeah. We don't have any, you know, we don't have any police powers yet. Malpractice, you probably only have to get me some because I'm operating like a lawyer. We don't have a boiler. Now, individual and blanket bonds, normally you need those when you're handling a significant amount of finances. So, you know, as the auditor controller of the county, I had a bond, as the county treasurer has a bond. Most of the elected officers have a bond. We probably should investigate that.
Okay.
And then I don't think we need anything for forgery or money securities. That's us committing forgery. I'm not sure that. What do you guys think?
Who's the beneficiary of the insurance?
The beneficiary of the insurance is us, as a board of directors. So it would cover us in case of a lawsuit.
Right, but in terms of forgery.
You know, forgery might be.
Beneficiary.
The beneficiary.
So if I engage in forgery.
Yeah, but it.
How does it work in terms of insurance?
They would reimburse the district.
For the amount that I stole.
Right.
But only if I'm covered. So if somebody else does that and they're not part of the insurance policy, then we're not covered?
Well, I think that the forgery would cover the agency, and you could have forgery either by the public or by a member of the board or by a finance officer of the board.
Yeah, they would protect the district as a whole. Yeah.
So, but this is a little different than directors and officers insurance, correct?
You know, I don't
know.
I just brought
here's
the one thing that my point here was. When I talked to the county risk manager, he said, "All I think you need is general liability at the time. Here's it. Here's his communication with me." And I didn't print the application because when I looked at it, it was a 23-page Excel spreadsheet, and I'm going, "Oh, well, that would mean that I'm going to sit down and fill out an insurance application." And am I? That's why I sent this to Ethan at one point, and he sent it back to the formation committee. So now between us, it's, well, who's going to fill out that application, and who's pretty, you know, the first thing I am, I'm not that knowledgeable about insurance because we always had a risk manager. I just blew it off. And so I go, I have a hard time doing my own insurance, you know. I'm probably way overpaying what I need, and I need to go do that. But, you know, I just rely on a third-party expert to go cover the county. And so.
So it seems like the next step we should do is to ask the board to direct us to engage in fact-finding with an actual agent.
Do you think we already have the authority in that they referred this item back to us?
This is an area where we do have to be careful. So which insurance agent are we going to talk to?
Right.
And does somebody know them, or were they married to them, or are they a CODA?
Right.
If they're a CODA, we can't deal with them.
That's why I put this stuff in here from Ray, where he says, "Hey, Bob, I just asked county council for some help," who asked the risk manager, who referred to me and said, "Here's our insurance provider. I've helped other districts get insurance, and you know, I'm not favoring them or anything. Here, fill out an application and get a quote."
So it seems like if we wanted to follow this through and not get too deep into stepping into stuff, is we have a non-interested insurance person
help us.
Just come in and give us a half hour briefing on, because I want to know what's the difference between directors and officers and general liability to the district. So and how are those separated?
You want for the formation committee?
Yeah, I think the formation committee, and then
I think that would be good, because I'm still not entirely clear, even if we're talking about like someone that's providing us an insurance policy between, like, I know there's the SDRME, RMA, and they're technically like a quasi-special, they're a JPA, and what's the difference between that and a private company that would be providing a private insurance company?
I would say probably that this Alliant that we're using is probably the insurer through the county, the CSAC pool. So Alliant does business with the county supervisory association, and we have insurance with them. And then we have these huge,
self-insured.
We're not self-insured. I think we have those huge blanket policies that are like they're in a pool.
Berkshire Hathaway.
Anything greater than $500,000 reinsurance.
We're in
a reinsurance pool. So that's where I think this Alliant comes from.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we should look at the Special Districts Association.
So maybe we ask them to come, somebody in. They, and even if it's a conference call on a phone,
that's what I think.
We call them and say, "Who's your sort of insurance guru? Can we just talk to them for 20 minutes?" Then we go back to the board and say, we need to prepare an RFP, because I do think with insurance, if we're going to go out and get it, and I absolutely believe it's one of the first things we should do,
mm-hmm.
but we need an RFP that mm-hmm. essentially says...
This is what we're, that, instead anybody, of me filling out that application, we should say, well, what is it we want and understand what we want.
Right.
Okay.
And then it's open to anybody. Anybody right. can send in, any insurance broker in town can send in a
right.
Proposal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that sounds great. And I would say that given that we have our trial membership for the special districts, the CSDA approved, and that will begin on April 1st.
Right.
As soon as April 1st rolls around, we can have someone give them a call and ask them if they can send a representative.
Or just do it on the phone.
Or just do it on the phone, yeah. Well, we can just explore our options.
What's the name of that organization?
The California Special Districts Association.
Yeah.
So I don't know who the point of contact should be for that, if we can have the committee chair of this committee do that, or if we throw it to the board president, since the board president has been the point of contact in the past with the CSDA.
I think in terms of protocol for the CSDA, I would think that a request by the president would okay. be, you know, so they're not getting multiple requests from seven different district directors here.
Mm-hmm.
It seems right. to me that the respect that they would give them mm-hmm. is they...
That's what I'm thinking too.
That Ethan would be...
So that's another one of your policy?
No, this is not a policy thing. No.
The policy is
that
when we contact the California Special Districts Association, it should go through one person.
Well, that, I don't think it necessarily needs to be in the policy manual. I think that would be part of a broader point of contact policy that would take place.
I could just see that can open up where any director feels like they can call the CSDA at any time and ask for help.
Yeah. Okay.
I know
what you're saying.
But and then they have a problem. It's not our problem. It's their problem, which is who do we talk to?
I mean, right.
We just talked to somebody yesterday about this, and.
Okay.
So did you say that as a motion? Your motion is to have the president request. That the California Special District Association give us a primer on insurance needs, and that would be followed up with an RFP to insurance providers.
Wait, so I'm sorry, I'm confused about the end of that motion.
Are you going to separate it into two motions?
Yeah.
Okay, so the first motion is to have the president request the president to ask the California Special District Association
to make a presentation to the formation committee.
To make a presentation to the former formation committee on our insurance needs.
Okay, and I second.
Okay.
Call for the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, so then the second motion, and maybe it's premature, but just to keep things rolling along here, is then. Once we've had that presentation, that the board put out an RFP for the insurance providers for an insurance policy.
Since there's so many insurance providers, do we want an insurance provider?
Okay. I feel like we could take that action once we get the presentation, right?
Okay. All right.
Okay.
All right. We'll table it.
Okay.
You're right, but there's probably only three or four.
We might want to limit that RFP to insurance providers that have experience with government.
Well, that's exactly what we
yeah.
could. And they won't. They well, I don't know.
Yeah, they all have experience with government, right? All we want is a good deal and cheap, and you know that's why I kind of look at somebody like Ray and go. But who knows? Maybe the county's not getting cheap insurance. I don't know.
Well, they have their own bank of attorneys.
Yeah. Yeah,
and that's the thing that's the whole thing there. That's what you end up paying the insurance for.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Right. Great. We're done with three?
Yeah, you're 5 minutes ahead of schedule.
Reviewing this.
No. You're actually 30 minutes ahead.
I'm 3 minutes ahead.
Wow.
So then the next one was to the review this work plan that I had. And I had some thoughts about this work plan. It had to do with, I don't know, does everybody have a copy? Anybody want a copy?
Yeah, I'll take a hard copy. That's pulled up.
George, you need a copy?
You got one? Or?
I'm going to try and see if I can find one. That'll be half the...
I'll give you another one.
Okay, yeah, and before we get too far into this, because I just see right across this paper the Gmail, do you have...
I have not.
Okay, just clarifying.
It's on my to-do list. And sweet. I'll try and use your correct one from now on. I get the habit of just pushing buttons, you know.
Trust me, I do too. I send emails from the wrong one sometimes.
So here's what made me think about this list that I put together. One, if you look at the first line, establish administrative service for the district in accordance with statutes that guide district operations. I didn't compile this list by looking at the statutes. I compiled this list by looking at the state controller's guidelines for expenditure accounts. So that was my first go. Oh, if I'm going to put together a task list, where can I go that is kind of comprehensive? So then I thought, if my mission though is to do statutes with guidelines, when I was reading the statutes, I saw that they had their own set of accounts in the statutes. And I said, I should rethink that, this task list, to more be in line maybe with us picking out from the statutes what administrative tasks we need to do and use that as the, along with this, maybe use that as our you know, formation committee, what we need to work on. Because maybe there's stuff I'm missing. I know when I was reading that, the statutes, I go, it talked about insurance and it had a reference to a different government code outside that code. I said, I should go read that code to see what it says about insurance to learn more about complying with the code. So I guess a future task, and I think it would be a good exercise for us on the formation committee, to actually go over the statutes. I know, you know what? They're really not very, once you get
Can
them.
I call
Once you get them,
can I call Plotkey?
Yeah. get the statutes, yeah. Lined up, they're not very onerous. Okay. It's not.
So what are the? You want to tell us what the statutes are?
So the statutes. I spent a day copying.
You're talking just about government code, right?
I'm talking about the community services, government code for community services.
So it's
district.
Like section 612.
61,000 through, and I didn't know how to print out the rest of it. It's 61,000 through, and it even goes through, I think the last is, it's, it actually, for districts, it's 58,000 through 62,208. Community services district are 61,000 through 61,250. And then there's a section on revitalization that would apply to us. And it's 62,000 to, 62,008.
Okay.
And for that revitalization section would be something that could apply to us in the long run.
Is that the post-RDA?
Infrastructure Financing District, okay. Right.
Is that, we didn't agendize that item. Is that something that we should put on our agenda for future meetings to discuss?
Is it on the working document?
No, sort of it is on the working document.
I thought I saw it on there.
If it's on the working document, then we can.
Implement, I don't know, Infrastructure Financing District, right?
Yeah, that's what it's called.
But in terms of doing that on the working document, if we looked at the law and the legal structure, I would say, in terms of a near term, Well, that would be a longer term thing we'd want to work on. You know, and so that's what I was hoping this document could flush out.
Yeah.
Well, what are we doing as formation in the short term versus the long term? And if we had a good working document, we might want to just align it by, you know, these chapters and say, okay, here's what we accomplished. We, you know, under chapter 3 was board of directors. That's what triggered the treasurer discussion. So, you know, we could go through here and do some subs and say we should make that as a work, something to work on. And then you say, well, when's the formation committee's job done? Well, it's done when we think we've set up all the administrative tasks that comply with the statutes.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
That's great.
Yeah, so I think that this document that has all of these things, and maybe we should consult the statutes first and add things to it,
yeah.
But this needs to be something that is an official document that we forward to the board and say, approve this as our
work plan.
As our work plan.
Right. And I was going to say, well, let's take this. And then I sat back when they said, well, what's the task? And I said, well, I set a goal that I didn't do. And so when I was working on the treasury thing, I said, oh, I should redo this. So I can put some effort to rework this.
Okay.
So let me just go back to that because I like to take things out of order. Now, I just told me that I have to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to look at 6. So I've been thinking about this for 2 years now, the post-RDA. I got to learn the terminology.
Right. Infrastructure financing.
And I've talked to, you know, I've talked to Joan about it. I've talked to other people about it.
Yeah, Joan talked to me about it a little bit.
So what it makes, given that it's probably a 2-year process from start to when you start pushing it up the hill to when you can actually do it, would it make sense to in some way try to begin the discussion now? And see, here's the problem is I don't know anything about this infrastructure other than it was set up by Jerry Brown to replace the RDAs.
Right.
And everybody who kind of looks at it really carefully goes, it's a great idea, but it won't work.
Yeah, and I've kind of heard some of the similar things. I think one of the big differences that the RDAs had issues, well, they were taking portions of tax revenues that otherwise would have gone to education. So this explicitly they're not
education.
Excludes
yeah.
education.
Yeah.
But it also put, there's, you have to have more cooperation instead of, they act a little less autonomously than RDAs did.
Yeah.
And you could probably give us the primer on the RDAs.
So it's interesting, you know, the RDAs got formed,
I don't know,
we formed ours in the 70s. And when you formed the RDAs, nobody really knew what people were doing.
Mm-hmm.
So our school districts could have exempted out of the RDA. There was that section of the law.
Mm-hmm.
Even Goleta West Sanitary could have exempted out. But nobody really knew what was happening. Everybody
mm-hmm.
played nice, and they formed this RDA because Bill Wallace and company wanted to do it by an
mm-hmm.
open space. They never knew the power of that tax increment, and
mm-hmm.
barely in the auditor's office did we understand, my predecessor understand really how tax increment financing works. People
mm-hmm.
just didn't get it. But so now when now other counties formed RDAs and they exempted their general fund from participating in the RDA and nailed the school districts, and the school districts
mm-hmm.
didn't care for the community because they got backfilled by the state and they were never going to be a basic aid school district living on property taxes. So it was the community screwing the state. And so Jerry Brown goes, well, that ain't going to happen anymore because we're backfilling schools. We're not going to let you have property tax increment. And so therefore, they're excluded. Under the new legislation, the only way to get the tax increment flowing again is with the agreement of the agencies.
Mm-hmm. And the tax increment is
important. And that would be, you'd have to get
county
the general fund.
Yeah.
You'd have to get all its dependent special district, which is
uh-huh.
flood, service area 31, fire. And then you would have to get Goleta West Sanitary. So those are the agencies you'd be dealing with as a one independent, the county and its dependent districts, and that's who you'd get money from. So, you know, Lavanino sent to me at a meeting, don't come back here and ask for anything that affects the general fund. And I said, well, I might come back to you and talk to you where it's to the mutual benefit of both of us. And so the trick on an infrastructure financing is you want to sell to the county and Goleta West Sanitary District that it's in your best interest that we do infrastructure financing for this community that would, number one, raise the value of property taxes and get more money into the infrastructure and keep improving the infrastructure, the district, which will benefit the private sector, the tax roll that creates more money. It's a
for the general fund.
It's Peter Adams and their, you know, the them of the world that says, or Joe Armendariz, if you watch Joe, you know, all boats will rise if you increase the value of the public sector. And that's the sales pitch you have to do on RDAs. And for Isla Vista, I believe it was really working with redevelopment that we were mm-hmm. raising the values of the private sector. Right. And that's how we ended up with all that money. And so you have to go sell that. That's the sales job.
Okay, so that helps me understand it. And I think at this point in time, you're right. That's a tough sales job, and it's probably one that will be better accomplished down the road mm-hmm. when the CSD is able to show its ability to deliver.
Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, I
can see you only need one to say no, and it doesn't fly.
I think you could get that done with a tax exchange with a majority vote, but. Mm-hmm. Mm. I probably should ask county
council.
You've
convinced me that we'll put that off to another meeting.
Yeah, it's a big deal, and it's a big deal for everybody to understand, and we'd want to really be ready with a good sales pitch.
Well, and that's why I've always thought it should come from Joan's office. That's where it should come from.
So here's my real pitch. That taxing agencies today in Isla Vista are still paying the redevelopment agency. So tax increment is still flowing to the redevelopment agency that is paying off debt. Okay. The first thing we might want to study is, well, how much money is that? Because you could make a theoretical argument of, well, why don't we do a tax exchange agreement once that expires, and you keep whoever benefits from that when it goes away, you keep giving that to the agency so that we can continue to deliver some of the operational services that the RDA was doing. And therefore, it doesn't hurt you.
So who knows that? Who knows the length of those bonds?
I can find out. Right? I think it's 2 years, two more years.
Oh, so it's very short.
Yeah, within our, and if you could say, the thing you're saying is, well, Steve Lavanino, Steve, you weren't getting that money anyways. Why don't you just do a tax exchange and give it to us and we'll provide this service and we'll also relieve you of this service. You have to.
Well, can we put that on a future agenda?
We should. And okay. Then on top of that, that would be the time to strike. Well, you're not gonna get the benefit. Can you give us the benefit for infrastructure of this? I say you bring them together, you try and get the flow that's existing, and you try and do that infrastructure financing. And we confuse the shit out of them that they don't know, just like Wallace did.
Hold on a second. Let me confuse the shit out of
them. No, I forgot you're recording this. But you know, what we really need to do is convince them that this.
What do you call that? A tax?
It's called tax increment.
No, I know tax increment. What's the other one? A tax exchange?
A property tax exchange agreement.
That's one I haven't heard of.
So, a property tax exchange agreement between two government agencies is we'll give you this much in property taxes if you take over this service.
Got it.
So they give you taxes for you taking the cost of the service. So if we were going to do some program that the county, let's say you decided to take over street lighting. Then you could do a tax exchange agreement between County Service Area 31 and the Community Services District. They give you the taxes that are funding the street lighting program, and you take over the program. That's an example of a property tax exchange, not between the county, but the burden we relieve the service area and the county of is managing the streetlight program, and we get the taxes in exchange for that to run it.
Now, is that within our purview of services?
Sidewalks, streetlights, street trees.
That's within our purview.
The district?
Yeah.
I believe so, yes.
And it's not in that area, it's not just to augment those services, it's we could take over those services.
There's a line in AB3 that talks about the district not supplanting services right. that are being provided by UCSB or the county. So
yeah. I
that
think
would have to be looked into.
I think under the language of that law, where we're authorized to provide the services, and we wouldn't be supplanting if we did the property tax exchange.
So on the next agenda, can we, future agenda item, discuss property tax exchange agreement, the RDA increment.
Let's come back to that in a second. How about did we finish an action item on the review and discuss the inventory services document?
I think that we should. I don't know if we necessarily need a recommendation on this. What we just really need to do is establish that we're all going to review this.
I think internally, there's no recommendation. You're right. There's no recommendation.
So we're just going to review it.
The action is just to continue to work on what do we want to call this, an inventory, or do we want to call this continue to work on the administrative tasks?
We'll just call it the administrative plan.
Yeah.
Is that easier?
Yeah, that would be good.
And you've given us homework.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm thinking.
Is it going to be on the final, or can we write a paper?
Don't say that the F word, George. I just finished up. Yeah, I did.
I was wondering why you were in such a jovial spirits today. I was listening to a student explain it, and I have to admit it goes way, way back. But the day after or the day of your last final exam, they were trying to explain to another student the feeling.
Oh, yeah. Oh, trust me, yeah. Everyone is so happy. Well, people who have finished. I have some housemates that haven't finished.
Oh.
Some friends that haven't finished.
All right.
Trying to vicariously, get the juices of...
It's okay, George.
Suddenly there's a final end point, and you go, I'm done with that.
So continue to work on the formation committee... Yeah. Administrative plan. Administrative task plan or whatever.
And I can eventually the goal would be at the next meeting we comb through this more, bring our suggestions to how to improve it, forward it to the board for approval as an official and have them officially say, these are the things we want you to be working on.
Yeah.
And then it'll be part of the committee's charter, essentially.
Right. Okay. I don't know if we'll get it done at the next meeting, but it might take us a little bit to get through the code sections.
Okay. So do we want to, that's the other thing, though. Do we want to assign specific parts of the code sections, or do we just all want to come through it ourselves? It might be a little more efficient if we said...
I think if you take an hour to read it, then we would have a more formative discussion, and our different brains might pick up on different things we should be working on. It's not each section's only about You know, I put the whole, all the sections we'd have to work on in this binder, and the infrastructure section's the biggest, so. It's not hard. Some of these chapters are really short, 2 pages.
Oh, yeah, no, definitely.
Yeah.
So it's the special district section.
Yeah.
In particular, the community services district section.
It's, they have a general provision section, which is kind of nice to read because it says what's the it gives a good summary of what the future of a community services district could be in the long run.
Mm-hmm.
The next one's the internal organization.
Mm-hmm.
And some of that's a little tiny bit different on chapter 1 and 2 because of the special, the Isla Vista Community Service District special legislation.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, chapter 3, 4, and 5 are pretty easy. And then the chapter 3 is really the purpose, services, and facilities. So. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, I don't think there needs to be
call for the question.
No. Well, we
Okay, call for the question on number 4. Aye. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
All right. Number 5. Let's just skip 5 for a second, and then the property tax exchange agreement, you would like that to be a topic for a future
agenda item.
Okay. And do we want to put on infrastructure financing or wait? Are you more interested?
Let's wait. And if you have anything on it.
On a property tax exchange agreement?
No, on this infrastructure.
Financing?
Financing. There's not much written on it.
It's
that
just
I
the
code.
You can read the code, and it's very confusing because it uses a lot of terminology in there that you have to understand the theoretical. What I could probably do for you guys is maybe in terms of a property tax exchange. We could also bring in the tax allocations for the tax rate areas for that the community services district is in. And once you understand the tax rate areas and you understand, you know, how that grows, then you'll also get some of the issues related to a property tax exchange.
Okay.
So like when the city of Goleta was formed, there was a property tax exchange agreement as part of the formation of that city. They got revenue from the county general fund. They got revenue from county service area 3. And
they gave up.
And they don't like it.
They gave up their TOT and their sales tax forever.
No. They got their TOT back. Their 100% sales tax on revenue neutrality. And they got... they only are giving up 30% of their sales tax. But you have to take that a little farther. Who built the big box and permitted it? The county did.
Yeah.
And therefore, if they didn't vote for that revenue neutrality, the city would have never got formed because LAFCO would have said it can't pay for itself.
I got it.
You're adversely hurting the county. But they don't say it, hear that. Anyways, okay. So discuss a formation committee project for internship, number 5, to assist the formation. Do you think
we would... I'm going to step out.
Oh, you're going to step out.
I'm going to step out. So you'll have to take the minutes for this last part. And then also, who do I send the minutes to? Each of you, I'll send the minutes to you. I'll just send them...
Are you just going
to
step out for a second?
No, I'm going to step out for this discussion. But that's the last item on the agenda. Is there anything else on the agenda that we need to discuss? No, I'm going to step out for the internship.
There's nothing else that we need to discuss. Anything else for future agenda?
For future agenda items?
You want to scan this list real quick and see if we think of some? Let me just bring up an issue on that office still. I woke up the other day and said, every time I'm in this room, that office is empty.
It's empty.
I take my ethics class, and it says you got to have a place for your records. You got to have a physical location for your records. You need an emailing address. I go, well, that's just bullshit from one government agency to another to say that that vacant space couldn't be given to us. So I think...
And I was thinking about this the other day. I 100% agree with you. I think that it's like... The more that I thought about it, it would be nice to try to manage it as some sort of a community space, but at the end of the day, we need a physical place to comply with the California Records Act.
So my suggestion as we do this is, first of all, we don't blindside Joan on it.
Right.
And number two is we ask the county to give us the space and to agree that we don't have to pay for it until some point in the future. Now, is that possible? Can the county waive current payment for it?
I think the key to this is to talk to Janet Wolf and get her position of whether, if we brought this to a vote, if we brought a lease to the board. If
are you familiar with any other agencies in the county, like us, who get free space from the county?
How about the art museum? How about Alpha Resource Thrift Center up by the fire department that own they're on our parcel? How about Page Youth Center? How about the Little League baseball field?
That's right. Page Youth Center pays a buck, right?
Yeah.
So does the food bank.
Yeah.
Food bank pays a buck.
Right. So this is not
unusual.
In fact, well, all those are private. Those are non-profits, right? But we're another government agency, and, theoretically, we should run these at some point in time when the bonds are paid off, and if we get our legs under us, we should be running these buildings. I mean, these are in the county's name, but think theoretically who bought these buildings. Freaking taxing agencies bought them. That's why it's an understanding this property tax exchange stuff and what the taxes are. Mm-hmm. And I should bring in here at the meeting, maybe we can get the amount of contributions going to pay off that debt by the taxing agencies. The tax increment.
Are you ready to make a motion to take to the board that indicates that we're going to make a formal request to the county for use of that building for 1 year? At $1 a year until such time as we can.
I think we should go see if we have a
third vote. Well, that has.
Yeah, that's what I'll do. So I'll.
Do you feel comfortable doing that?
Do we need to give him direction to reach out to Joan's office and.
No, I don't think you want that in the minutes.
I can't, that I have to avoid the Brown Act there, but I've only talked to Joan about it, so I know who we have I'm guessing we have two votes and we have a middle vote. The problem with the LAFCO members, the Board of Supervisor members that sit on LAFCO are a little bit tainted with the they're believing the mission of LAFCO, and some of them feel like, well, you took this route to go get legislation to be independent. Now you're independent. Now
go fly.
Don't rely on the general fund.
Right.
And I think we have to get back and convince the Board of Supervisors that it's in their best interest that we have a presence in that room. For the good of the community. I mean, that's the only thing I can think about doing.
Well, can I just say that it's the same struggle with the university. We need to continually reinforce to the university that it's in their best interest that this CSD thrive.
Yeah.
Because there's clearly a lot of people out there that don't want it to thrive.
Right, and I think you get the same thing with Yeah.
So do we put it on our agenda or do we put it on the board agenda?
The
room.
The room?
Yeah.
Probably our agenda. So it doesn't sound like we're far enough to take it
I
to
think,
the board yet.
Let's see if we could formulate something on our agenda.
Okay.
About the room. And, you know, that's the other thing is at some point it formally needs to come from the full board to ask, yeah. And mm-hmm. then let mm-hmm. the Board of Supervisors tell us no and make them say why. I mean, I got the polite.
Yeah, that's okay.
We're not going to subsidize the district. We have to get around that, you know. So somehow we have to make it, we have to think about, maybe we can think about this.
Well, what's there?
How do we make it beneficial to the county that we occupy that room?
Because we're going to, it's now closed off. How about if our trade-off is that we're going to staff it a certain number of hours a day.
Here's a good thought. If you, when you read in this code and you read the introductory provisions, there's some pretty interesting good language in there about why they rewrote the community services district law. And it makes you think about the bigger purpose of what a community service district, why we're empowering a community services district, and it's really to act like a city. We can't act like a city.
We don't have an office.
We don't have an office.
Yeah.
Well, and this goes to the community, because Pagin made the comment in our last meeting, which is what we need to do is to approach the Board of Supervisors from the point of view of we would only be one use of it. We'd also ensure that it's become some kind of community space too. Now, how we
the question is though, can we make that our district office if we do it that way?
I don't know.
Because the main thing here in my mind that I think we're going to keep coming back to is we need a place to call the district office for. Right. Purposes of people being able to come and make requests for housing public records, all
so
these things.
I agree. You gotta have the most important one's the repository of the public records. Yeah. That's just a locked cabinet.
Mm-hmm.
The people
mm-hmm.
now, granted, somebody could come in and steal the locked cabinet.
It could be public. It could be public yeah. records, and it could be our electronic records in a server.
Mm-hmm. But we do. There are certain physical.
Has anybody been in there?
Many months ago, I went in there with
Esther. There's a back room and there's two rooms, right?
Yeah, I haven't been in the back room. I've only been in the front room, where there's
Can I say when also, speaking of gifts and the problems of gifts, is that Ed St. George, during the discussion of the
what?
Sobering Center. Because the Sobering Center was going to go in there. Now, I don't think the Sobering Center is going to go in there anymore, but that's something that could come up.
Doesn't now.
At some point, somebody might come out of the woodwork and say, but that's where we were going to put the Sobering Center.
Right.
But Ed St. George had agreed mm-hmm. to do in-kind mm-hmm. donation work to get the offices up to speed. So there is an existing, but it's an issue of, is there a quid pro quo? Because he's going to be somebody that the district will have jurisdiction over. But,
mm-hmm.
I don't know, I'm just throwing those out. I think maybe you should talk to the informally to the supervisors and just see if, and then ask them what would we need to do to get the third vote.
So does the park district share their office space?
No. Not to my knowledge.
And they're really crammed.
Yeah, I know they are, but they do have a district boardroom, right?
No.
Not exactly, no.
No. When they have their board meetings, they just meet
in the office.
In the bullpen.
Yeah, I thought they used to have some seats in there when I used to.
Well, they put
well,
they
do,
put seats
but I
in
mean, it's basically just the office floor. Like, there are desks.
I mean, I'm kind of curious why they don't move their meetings over here. It'd be so much more comfortable and accessible.
Considering the amount of attendance they get, I think it's just easier for them to meet there.
Yeah.
I mean, we're going to find the same thing in the long run, probably, that, you know, the attendance at our meetings will drop off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, I do you really?
Yeah. I mean, unless it gets the public really involved, so.
I know.
Well, I would hope that the public continues to stay involved. I think there's going to be a lot of things we do that.
Yeah.
So I will put
that on our next
the
agenda.
Room on our next agenda. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. And then my task is to you're going to send me letterhead, and I'm going to get two items going so we can get them on the board agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And then the last thing we'll talk about is
internship. Okay.
And the letterhead
is
for.
I'll write the minutes, and I'll have the minutes to you guys by Sunday.
Okay.
Okay.
You need the minutes by, or do you need them by today?
They just need to be before the next meeting, preferably by.
Oh, we didn't talk about next meeting.
Well, what's the noticing requirement?
For the next meeting? For this
for the
meeting,
next
or for the board,
board
next
meeting.
Board meeting?
Yeah.
I'm hoping to finalize the agenda by a week from today.
Oh, so is it? Oh, we just had the meeting this week. Okay, so I can get these two.
Or
Sunday.
Maybe
I can
it's
get
a week from yesterday.
Sunday. I'll get these.
Yeah,
two
I'm hoping
Sunday.
A week from today.
I was thinking you had to.
The sooner you get him to me, the sooner I'll finish the.
Yeah, I mean honestly, yeah. Okay.
Even though I got
the sooner the better.
Okay. Sooner the better. Right.
But then you'll give me those, and then I'm gonna take. Minutes for this last for yeah. item number six.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. When's
and
the next?
Do,
when's
do,
our
we
next
do
meeting?
We need what? To set a next meeting yeah. date, and do we? I don't know if we want to set a regular meeting schedule so that we can always have room reserved. So that we, so, because that's one of the things is that this room is not always going to be available. As exemplified by the fact that we had to change what we originally decided in the last committee meeting. So, for example, on another committee, they took action to set a regular meeting schedule that was the second and fourth. Ooh, let me see if I can find this. The second and fourth Mondays.
Let me ask you
of
guys.
Each month.
Do you think it would be advantageous for us to always follow our meeting after the regular board meeting? Do you think that would help us with tasks and then have enough time to get our whatever agenda items that we get through our committee onto the next board meeting? So it's,
yeah, yeah. Well, it definitely needs to fall in between the 2 week kind of thing that we've got going on where we've got the first and third Tuesdays of each month.
Right.
It needs to fall somewhere between that. Preferably closer to the back end of that time frame or the front end of that time frame so that we have time to work on things.
That's what I would think.
So say if right now that it if
do
you're
we
looking
like
at a
Fridays?
Calendar
or do we prefer Thursdays?
We can do Fridays. I think Fridays, preferably in the morning. Actually, you know, Friday at 10 would be a good time.
Friday at 10, we could, let's do Friday at 10.
Okay, and now we have to choose.
The same week as the board meeting.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that would be the first and third Fridays of each month.
Yeah.
Yeah, sometimes Fridays are going to be complicated for me.
Yeah, I would be better on Thursdays.
Okay.
Thursdays are better for me. Oh, as if we're going to meet.
Mm-hmm. So, do we want to do... Because my Thursdays are
bad.
Not the best days. That's one of my class days. We could do... See, if we're going to do Wednesdays, we shouldn't do... The first and
Let's
third, we should do the second and fourth. Not do Wednesdays?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't give it enough time between the. Yeah.
Exactly.
So, I mean,
Let's
I'm
stick
okay
with
Fridays and then play it by ear.
Yeah.
Is that
okay.
We can always cancel regular meetings
right.
and schedule
right.
special
yeah.
meetings
right. okay.
if we anticipate that
okay.
there's going to be an issue.
Okay,
so first and third Fridays.
Yeah, cool.
First and third Fridays at 10 a.m. in this room.
Yeah,
is that a motion?
Until we get to it. Sure.
I second.
Call for the question?
Okay.
All in favor.
Until we get to the summer.
Aye.
I think we may summertime maybe. When are you going to Alaska?
I'm probably going to Alaska from
Did you vote on that question?
June first to the 15th.
Okay.
So I've missed one board meeting.
Okay.
and then I have a trip to Seattle for a week, and then in September I have a trip to Ireland for 2 weeks. Okay. And I have a trip to Toledo, my hometown, for 4 days over the 4th of July.
I thought Ireland had a trip to IV, and it was during the summer.
Yeah, it is. It's our exchange program.
I have four sets of plane tickets. And
did I read that correctly, that the Parks Board gets $165 a meeting?
I think so.
Were you on the board?
I was not on the Parks Board. Oh. I don't know.
You get $165 a meeting.
There's other boards that get...
I know.
Yeah, quite a bit more than that.
I'm not in any way suggesting.
There are some districts...
But I didn't realize they got so much.
...whose board members make about $25,000 a year.
Wow.
And go into meetings.
There are limits on how much board members can make.
Yeah, they get to go.
Yeah.
Goleta West gets to go to 6 meetings per month. And Goleta Water gets to go to 10 meetings per month. And so every time they get paid for the committee meetings, the subcommittee meetings, and they get paid for going to the Special Districts Association.
They can actually also get paid for going and representing the organization at other special district meetings. I know that because I'm not going to name this person, but they came and they let me know that was one of the reasons that they were at first CSD meeting.
Exactly.
So,
okay. Good meeting. Thanks.
All
thanks
right,
for the work.
Thanks, George.
See you guys.
Okay. So,
so on the discussion, I was just thinking, I love the internship programs, and I like to teach people, and it would be kind of fun to have somebody work with us on mm-hmm. formation committee items and, mm-hmm. agendizing this stuff. And I think mm-hmm. there's a lot of things we could teach,
mm-hmm.
but maybe now that it doesn't work because George is on the committee. I'm just thinking, mm-hmm. is that conflict?
Yeah.
Well, is he going to always have that conflict that he can't jointly with the, I look at it as if we had an intern, we would just be, the three of us would be teaching them,
mm-hmm.
Things. We could have them read the code. Mm-hmm. We could have them take the ethics class.
Mm-hmm.
We could, have them help us with the agenda committee items, have us, manage the long-term to-do list.
Mm-hmm.
It would be an interesting project for, I think, a student, but I don't, now that I think of the conflict, George would have a hard time participating in that teaching effort.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that, I think that what we can do in this item, at least what I understand the board has asked us to do, is create sort of a hierarchy of needs that can be fulfilled by the interns. In my mind, that would fall further toward the bottom than things such as like taking minutes, noticing meetings, going and doing some of the outreach things right now that directors are currently performing. So, I think that having a intern assigned to a committee, that's the other thing, is that we don't know how many interns, we don't know what intern committee is doing
right.
In terms of how many interns are going to get sent to us. That's kind of out of our control. I think what we do is we just establish, here are the things that the interns are going to do. Here's the hierarchy of things that we want them to do. And if we end up getting told, oh, we don't have enough interns to get down to, level 6 or level 7,
right,
then we don't have enough interns to do that. And I think, it is definitely, it's going to be a learning experience to see what kind of tasks we need them to fulfill in a lot of ways, because we're still kind of formulating what tasks need to get done and performed by the board and the district. So in my perspective, I'm hoping that that is communicated to people who are applying to this program, that this is going to be just as much of a learning experience for us as it is for them. So I'd say we make a hierarchy, we forward it to the board and say this is what we want. this is what we think the interns should be doing. Do you think
we as the formation committee should be thinking of what all the interns, or is that the internship committee going to do that? I guess we could take a higher, since we're going to have all this stuff, we could probably come up with some.
Well, I mean, the item says discuss a formation committee project for the internship program in order to assist the formation committee in carrying out its tasks for the spring quarter. So
yeah, I was thinking,
what were you thinking?
I was thinking that we would have the formation committee would have a project that the intern would work with us. It would be on our formation committee.
Okay. And, I thought that this was something that the board sent us to review.
Yeah, no.
Oh.
I was just thinking that we would only have an intern. Did they send it to us?
I didn't write it down.
Yeah, I didn't hear that from them. I wrote this from me saying when I was doing these agenda items,
mm-hmm.
I was thinking and going, oh, it'd be fun to kind of have an intern to challenge them to help mm-hmm. us write some of this stuff, or to help us move it along, or, you know, help us manage this task list. So that's how I was thinking of that, but I see how you read it different.
Yeah. And because I thought within the last board meeting discussion that we had, what we were talking about was how are the interns going to be managed? And I thought that the board forwarded that somewhere. Let me check. The meetings aren't official yet, or the minutes aren't official yet. I haven't sent them out, but I can look at this copy of them that I have.
I was kind of thinking of that, too, in terms of...
Oh, you know, that got directed to internship committee.
Yeah,
that's
good.
Yeah. Motion that internship committee discuss and develop recommendations for intern oversight and supervision and other tasks and the negotiation of future contracts and everything else to necessary for building a robust program.
Yeah. So what I meant by this mm-hmm. is we get an intern?
Okay.
And then we formulate a project plan
for
that intern to work on formation committee mm-hmm. stuff. That's what I was thinking.
Okay. Well, I would say, again, I think that's something that in the internship committee is going to work out.
So let's just table this.
Yeah. It would be really nice, though, to have a staff member assigned to the committee.
Yeah. When I think of the internship program, and I was thinking about it in terms of helping manage the person.
Mm-hmm.
So my typical way is for an internship, we at the county did it two ways. Some interns got to work on projects.
Mm-hmm.
Some interns got to work on claim processing. They both taught you good tasks. This is more operational,
mm-hmm.
and this is more
mm-hmm.
project level. Like, you know, we would have them do the statistical section of the financial report.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very interesting project, but that one, it's a repetitive task. This one would be us getting a project plan for the intern, and then kind of nobody's in direct supervision. We're supervising the project, not the person. And I think that's how you get around this direct supervision. It's here's a project we want you to mm-hmm. do. You go do the project and we'll help supervise that. That's what my thinking was. And I said, the formation committee would be an interesting project for 10 weeks for a student.
Okay.
And they would get something out
of
it. You know, when you think of these internship projects, you want to teach them. It's really the effort you're putting in is teaching them how public policy works, and
mm-hmm.
you know, we don't know how it's going to work, but they could, along with us, help accomplish what we're doing,
mm-hmm.
you know. And it's another body and another brain, and usually if you get a student, they come with these really good skills that I don't have. And those are like using Word and preparing documents
mm-hmm.
and dressing them up really nice and
that's part of the process of making good stuff. But I'd say we just table this to wait till we hear.
Okay, I think that sounds great.
Okay.
Good discussion, though.
Yeah, and I'll try and write it.
Okay.
Better the next time if I put it on there.
So since we didn't even take any action, that's good. I don't have to write any.
Just table for future meeting.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
So we already went through future meeting dates and agenda items.
Yep. First and third.
First and third.
Cool. All right. Meeting adjourned.
Yeah. Motion to adjourn.
Call for the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right.
Thanks for your patience,
Jerry. 1:52. 11:52. Oops.